Hey everybody, this is Brijesh here. My dear friends, there is a power given to income tax authorities to reassess your income even after your income has been assessed by the income tax authorities after making the assessment under section 143(3) of the Income Tax Act. Still, if in the opinion of the income tax officer, some income has escaped assessment that has not been taxed in the past, then he may reassess that income subject to the various time limits and conditions prescribed under the Income Tax Act. Reassessment is one of the weapons with the Income Tax Department which is used by it to assess, reassess or recompute income which has escaped assessment or on which tax has not been paid. In spite of various guidelines laid down by the various courts in respect of reassessment proceedings, generally these are not followed in letter and spirit by the department, resulting into quashing of the reassessment notices by the courts. From the various reassessment notices issued by the department, one can get the feel that Income Tax Department issues the reassessment notices as its right. However, Income Tax Department has most of the time failed to appreciate the real intent for putting the reassessment provisions in the Income Tax Act. Assessment orders can be overturned by reopening the assessments in casual manner. Finality of the assessment must be recognized as matter of principle, and reopening should be an exception only. During COVID-19 lockdown, Honorable Supreme Court delivered a landmark judgment under Section 147 of the Income Tax Act in the case of New Delhi Television Limited versus DCIT in Civil Appeal Number 1008 of 2020. The decision deals with basic principles related to issuance of notice, recording of regions, and opportunity of hearing. The Supreme Court once again reiterated the important legal principles in context to reopening of assessment beyond the period of 4 years. This decision will go a long way in understanding the legal principles in relation to reopening of assessment. In this video, I shall be discussing with you this landmark judgment. Keep watching this video till end in order to understand the various important aspects of reopening of assessment under Income Tax Act. I shall be discussing with you the facts of this case, also the various arguments given by NDTV before the Honorable Supreme Court shall be discussed here. Further, the argument of SSE countered by the Income Tax Department shall also be discussed. Various principles were pronounced by the Honorable Supreme Court in this case are also discussed by me in this video, which will help you in future when a reassessment notice, if any, is issued by the department to defend your case effectively. In this case, the appellant, that is New Delhi Television, is an Indian company engaged in running television channels of various kinds. It has various foreign subsidiaries. However, for present discussions, we are concerned mainly with its subsidiary based in United Kingdom named NDTV Network PLC UK, that is NNPLC. The reassessment proceedings in this case dealt with the issue of step-up coupon bonds amounting to $100 million. These bonds were issued in July 2007 through the Bank of New York for a tenure of 5 years. In this case, NNPLC issued step-up coupon bonds of $100 million, which were arranged by Jefferies International, and the funds were received by NNPLC through Bank of New York. The SEC agreed to furnish corporate guarantee for this transaction. For your easy understanding, this transaction is shown in the form of a flowchart on your screen here. These bonds were subscribed to by various entities. Bonds were to be redeemed at a premium of 7.5% after the expiry of period of 5 years. However, these bonds were redeemed in advance at a discounted price of US$74.2 million in November 2009. The return of income for assessment year 2008-09 were filed on 29th of September 2008, declaring a loss by the assessee. In the original assessment proceedings, it was held by the assessing officer that NNPLC had virtually no financial worth, it had no business of the name, and therefore it could not be believed that it could have issued convertible bonds of US$100 million unless the repayment along with interest was secured. This was secured only because of the assessee, that is NDTV, agreeing to furnish guarantee for this. Though the assessee had never actually issued such guarantee, the assessing officer was of the view that the subsidiary of the assessee could not have raised such a huge amount without having this assurance from the assessee, that is NDTV. The transaction was of such a nature that the assessee should be required to maintain an arm's length from its subsidiary, meaning thereby that it should be treated like a guarantee issued by any corporate guarantor in favor of some other corporate entity. The assessing officer did not doubt it, the validity of the transaction, but imposed guarantee fee at the rate of 4.68% by treating it as a business transaction and added Rs. 18.72 crore to the income of the assessee by order dated 3rd October 2012. Then after, this case was reopened by the AO on 31st of March 2015, that is beyond 4 years from the end of relevant assessment year, by issuing notice under section 148 of the Act on the ground that the net income chargeable to tax for assessment year 2008-09 has escaped assessment under section 148 of the Income Tax Act. The reasons for reopening were supplied to assessee on 4th August 2015. The main reason for reopening was that in the following assessment year, that is assessment year 2009-10, the assessing officer had proposed a substantial addition of Rs. 642 crores in the income of the assessee on account of monies raised by him through its subsidiaries, NDTV BV the Netherlands, and various other subsidiaries. The assessee raised objection before the Dispute Resolution Panel, that is DRP, for assessment year 2009-10, which came to the conclusion that all these transactions with the subsidiary companies in Netherlands were sham and bogus transactions, and that these transactions were done with a view to get the undisclosed income back to India by this circuitous round tripping for which tax had not been paid. For issuing the reassessment notice, the assessing officer relied upon the order of the DRP holding that there is a reason to believe that funds received by NNPLC were actually the funds of the assessee. This is an important observation. NNPCL had a capital of Rs. 40 lakh. It did not have any business activity in the UK except a postal address. It was unnatural for anyone to make such a huge investment of US$100 millions in virtually non-functioning company and then after get back only 72% of their original investment. The natural inference could be that it was NDTV's own funds introduced in NNPCL. Mention has also been made by AO of complaints received from a minority shareholder in which it is alleged that the money introduced in NNPLC was shifted to another subsidiary of SSE in Mauritius, from where it was taken to a subsidiary of the SSE in Mumbai and finally to the SSE. NNPLC itself was placed under liquidation on 28th of March 2011. Therefore, the assessing officer was of the opinion that there was reasons to believe that the funds received by NNPLC were the funds of the SSE under a sham transaction, and that the amount of rupees 405.09 crore introduced in the books of NNPLC during the AY89 through the transactions involving the step-up coupons convertible bonds pertains to the SSE. The SSE raised objection to the reassessment notice and reasons and claimed that there had been no failure on the part of the SSE to disclose fully and truly material facts necessary to make an assessment, that the proceedings had been initiated on a mere change of opinion and there was no reasons to believe that the transaction of step-up bonds was a legal and valid transaction. In addition, it was claimed that the assessing officer had no valid reason to believe that the income of the SSE had escaped assessment. According to the SSE, the AO had accepted the genuineness of the transaction by levying guarantee fee and adding it back to the income of the SSE. In the alternative, it was submitted that the notice has been issued beyond the period of limitation of 4 years. According to the SSE, it had not withheld any material facts and therefore the limitation of 6 years as applicable to the first proviso of section 147 would not apply in this case. As usual, the claim of the SSE was disposed of by the AO by the order dated 23rd November 2015, wherein the assessing officer held that there was non-disclosure of material facts by the SSE and the notice was issued within limitation period since NNPLC was a foreign entity and admittedly a subsidiary of the SSE and the income was being derived through this foreign entity. It was also held by the AO that the case of the SSE would fall within the second proviso of section 147 of the Act and the extended period of 16 years would be applicable. The objections raised by the SSE were accordingly rejected by the AO. SSE filed the writ petition before the Honorable High Court, which was dismissed by the High Court on 10th of August 2017. Against the said order, the SSE filed the appeal before the Honorable Supreme Court. Now, I will be discussing the various arguments put forth by SSE as well as revenue before the Honorable Supreme Court and various important principles laid down by the court. In this case, the Honorable Supreme Court did not went into the merits of the allegations made by the department against the SSE. The Supreme Court only decided whether the revenue has sufficient reasons to believe that undisclosed income of the SSE has escaped assessment and therefore there are valid grounds to issue notice. Further, the court considered the issue whether the facts which came to the knowledge of the assessing officer after the assessment proceedings for the relevant year were completed could be taken into consideration for coming to the conclusion that there were reasons to believe that income had escaped assessment. The SSE argued before the court that once the transaction of step-up coupon bonds has been accepted to be correct, then revenue cannot reopen the same and doubt the genuineness of the transaction based on the subsequent order of the DRP, that is Dispute Resolution Panel for assessment year 2009-10. According to the SSE, there is an attempt on behalf of the revenue to deliberately mix up the transactions relating to the Netherlands subsidiary with the UK subsidiary. According to revenue, tax evasion petitions were filed by the minority shareholders of the SSE company on various dates, which complaints describe in detail the communications between the SSE and the subsidiaries and also allegedly showed evidence of round-tripping of the SSE's undisclosed income through a layer of subsidiaries, which led to the issuance of the notice in question. The Honorable Supreme Court relied on its own decisions in the case of Claggett Brachy Company Limited, London versus CIT Andhra Pradesh, reported in 1989, 177 ITR 409, Mr. Phoolchand Bajanglal and others versus ITO, reported in 1993, 203 ITR 456, and SK Engineering Company Private Limited versus CIT Amritsar, reported in 2001, 247 ITR 818, for the proposition that subsequent facts which came to the knowledge of the assessing officer can be taken into account to decide whether the assessment proceeding should be reopened or not. Information which comes to the notice of the AO during proceedings for subsequent assessment year can definitely form tangible material to invoke powers vested with the AO under section 147 of the Act, the court held. Therefore, the court disagreed with the submissions of the assessee and observed that since the revenue discovered fresh tangible material subsequent to the assessment order of 3rd August 2012, it cannot be said that the assessing officer did not have reasons to believe that income had escaped assessment. This is very important observation of the court. At the stage of issuance of notice, the AO is to only form a prima facie view. Thus, the court held that the material disclosed in assessment proceedings for subsequent years was sufficient to form such a view, and there were reasons to believe that income had escaped assessment in this case. This principle was laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court. On the issue relating to whether there was a failure on the part of the assessee to make a full and true disclosure of all the relevant facts, the assessee argued that it has disclosed all the facts which were required to be disclosed. The revenue has placed reliance on certain complaints made by the minority shareholders, and it is alleged that those complaints reveal that the SSE was indulging in round-tripping of its funds. According to the revenue, the material disclosed in these complaints were clearly showing that the SSE is guilty of creating a network of shell companies with a view to transfer its untaxed income in India to entities abroad and then bringing it back to India, thereby avoiding the tax. The court refused to go into the above aspect of the matter because these complaints have not seen light of the day either before the High Court or before the Supreme Court. The case of the revenue is that the assessee did not disclose the amount subscribed by each of the entities, and furthermore, the management structure of these companies. The court observed that it was apparent from the records of the case that the revenue was aware of the entities which subscribed to the convertible bonds. The fact that step-up coupons bonds of $100 million were issued by NNPLC was disclosed. Who were the entities which subscribed to the bonds were also disclosed. And the fact that the bonds were discounted at a lower rate was also disclosed before the assessment was finalized. This transaction was accepted by the assessing officer, and it was held that the assessee was only liable to receive a guarantee fee on the same, which was added to its income. The court held that it cannot be said that the assessee withheld any material information from the revenue. The court further observed that the revenue can take the benefit of the extended period of limitation of 6 years for initiating proceedings under the first proviso to section 147 of the Act only if the revenue can show that the assessee had failed to disclose fully and truly all material facts necessary for its assessment. According to the court, the SSE had disclosed all the facts it was bound to disclose. If the revenue wanted to investigate the matter further, at that stage it could have easily directed the SSE to furnish more facts. Therefore, this objection of the revenue was not accepted by the court. On the question of whether the SSE had disclosed all the primary facts necessary for the assessment of its case to the AO, it was argued by the revenue that the SSE, in order to avoid detection of the actual source of funds of its subsidiaries, did not disclose the details of the subsidiaries in its final accounts, balance sheet and profit and loss account for the relevant period, as was mandatory under the provisions of Indian Companies Act 1956. The court observed that it was not disputed that the SSE obtained an exemption from the competent authority under the Companies Act 1956 from providing such details in its final accounts, balance sheet, etc. As such, it cannot be said that the SSE was bound to disclose this to the AO. The AO, before finalizing the assessment of 3rd August 2012, had never asked the SSE to furnish the details could observe. The court noted the fact that there was material on record to show that the SSE had not only disclosed the names of all the bondholders, but also their addresses, number of bonds, along with the total consideration received. This forms part of the assessment order dated 3rd August 2012 in the case of Messrs. NDTB Labs Limited and Messrs. NDTB Lifestyle Limited, which were passed by the same officer who had passed the assessment order in the case of the SSE on the same date itself. Therefore, the entire material was available with the revenue. The court held that all relevant facts were duly within the knowledge of the AO. Therefore, there was full and true disclosure of all material facts necessary for its assessment by the SSE. The court held that the SSE had disclosed all primary facts, that is very important, before the assessing officer, and it was not required to give any further assistance to the assessing officer by disclosure of other facts. It was for the assessing officer at this stage to decide what inference should be drawn from the facts of the case. Hence, duties and obligation of the SSE in assessment were defined by the court here. The Honorable Court relied on the decision of the case of Calcutta Discount Company Limited versus ITO Companies District 1st, Calcutta, reported in 1961, 41 ITR 191, wherein it was held that non-disclosure of other facts, which may be termed as secondary facts, is not necessary. The court therefore held that the SSE disclosed all the primary facts necessary for the assessment of its case to the AO, and it was not required to disclose the secondary facts before the AO. The court also noted the fact that revenue in its counter affidavit before the High Court had stated that it was not relying upon the non-disclosure of facts by the SSE, but before Supreme Court, the revenue had taken a contrary stand. It is interesting to note, the Supreme Court observed that whereas before this court, the revenue is strenuously urging that SSE is guilty of non-disclosure of material facts, but before the High Court, the case of the revenue was just opposite. We are also of the view, the court held, that the revenue could not be permitted to blow hot and cold at the same time. Even otherwise, Honorable Court held that the SSE had fully and truly disclosed all material facts necessary for its assessment, and therefore the revenue cannot take the benefit of extended period of limitation. The revenue also heard before the court that in terms of second proviso to section 147 of the Act read with section 149(1)(c) of the Act, the limitation period would be 16 years since the SSE has derived income from a foreign entity. The SSE contended that no income was derived from the foreign entity and a loan cannot be termed to be an asset or an income, and it is submitted that the notice cannot be said to have been issued under the second proviso. The court noted that notice dated 31st March 2015 is conceptually silent with regard to the second proviso. This notice does not rely upon the second proviso and basically relies on the proviso of section 148 of the Act. Very fine distinction done by the Honorable Court. The reasons communicated to the SSE on 4th August 2015 mention reasons to believe and non-disclosure of material facts by the SSE. However, there is no case set up in relation to the second proviso either in the notice or even in the reason supplied on 4th August 2015 with regard to the notice issued by the revenue. It was only while rejecting the objection of the SSE that reference has been made to the second proviso in the order of disposal of objections dated 23rd November 2015 by the revenue. Earlier, High Court relied upon the judgment in the case of Mohinder Singh Gill versus the Chief Election Commissioner, New Delhi, reported in AIR 1978 SC 851, and came to the conclusion that the revenue cannot rely upon the second proviso because the notice was silent in this regard. However, the court held that the SSE was guilty of the non-disclosure of material facts and upheld the reopening. The Honorable Supreme Court observed that it had already held that the SSE was not guilty of non-disclosure of material facts and the revenue has not challenged the judgment of the High Court insofar as the finding against it is concerned. However, Supreme Court permitted the revenue to defend the petition even on a ground which may have been decided against it by the High Court. On behalf of the revenue, it was urged that mere non-naming of the second proviso in the notice does not help the SSE. Very important observation made by the Supreme Court that the noticee or the SSE should not be prejudiced or be taken by surprise. It was observed by the Supreme Court that the uncontroverted fact is that in the notice dated 31st March 2015, there is no mention of any foreign entity. There is only mention of the section 148. Even after the SSE specifically asked for reasons, the revenue only relied upon the facts to show that there was reasons to believe that income has escaped assessment and this escapement was due to non-disclosure of material facts. There is nothing in the reasons to indicate that the revenue was intending to apply the extended period of 16 years. It is only after the SSE filed its reply to the reasons given by the revenue that in the order of the rejection for the first time, reference was made to the second proviso by the revenue. According to the court, this was not a fair or proper procedure. This is a very important observation by the court. The SSE must be put to notice of all the provisions on which the revenue relies upon. The notice and reasons given thereafter do not conform to the principle of natural justice, and the SSE did not get a proper and adequate opportunity to reply to the allegations which was being relied upon by the revenue. If the revenue is to rely upon the second proviso and wanted to urge that the limitation of 16 years would apply, then in the notice or at least in the reasons in support of the notice, the SSE should have been put to the notice that the revenue relies upon the second proviso. The court held. The assessee could not be taken by surprise at the stage of rejection of its objections or at the stage of proceedings before the High Court that the notice is to be treated as a notice invoking provision of second proviso of section 147 of the Act. This is very important principle propounded by the Honorable Court. The Honorable Court allowed the appeal of the assessee by holding that the notices issued to the assessee show sufficient reasons to believe on the part of the assessing officer to reopen the assessment. But since the revenue has failed to show non-disclosure of facts, the notice having been issued after a period of 4 years is required to be quashed. The Honorable Court also stated that they have not expressed any opinion on whether on facts of this case, the revenue could take benefit of the second proviso to section 147 read with section 149(1)(c) or not. Therefore, the revenue may issue fresh notice taking benefit of second proviso if otherwise permissible under the law. Therefore, this decision of the Apex Court is an important one as it reiterates various legal principles laid down in the context of the validity of the reassessment proceedings. The Supreme Court reaffirmed the principle laid down earlier that information which comes to the notice of the AO during proceedings for subsequent assessment years can definitely form tangible material to invoke powers vested with the AO under section 147 of the Act. This decision can prove to be an important precedent in cases where taxpayers have furnished appropriate material on record at the time of original assessment. In such cases, based on the facts of the case, the reassessment proceedings can be contended to be invalid if the same are initiated beyond 4 years. The decision emphasizes the onus on the taxpayer to disclose all material facts of the case during the course of the original assessment proceedings. As the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court held in the case of Calcutta Discount Company Limited, what facts are material and necessary for assessment will differ from case to case. Mere filing of books of accounts and financial statement would not tantamount to disclosure of material facts by the taxpayer unless specific entries or documents are brought to the attention of the AO by the taxpayer. Therefore, the Supreme Court in this case has given clarity on various important aspects relating to reassessment proceedings. The Honorable Supreme Court has accepted that subsequent facts which came to the knowledge of the AO can be taken into account to decide whether the assessment proceeding should be reopened or not. However, the Supreme Court rejected the invocation of extended period of limitation of 6 years as the taxpayer has disclosed all material facts before the AO and it was not required to give any further assistance to the AO by disclosure of other facts, that is, secondary facts. My dear friends, subsequent to this decision, revenue wasted no time in issuing fresh notices in the NDTV income tax reassessment case. This was done shortly after the Supreme Court quashed the earlier reassessment notice issued by the Income Tax Department for the year 2007-8. Important principles were laid down by the Supreme Court in this case. Subsequent information which comes to the notice of the AO during the proceedings for the subsequent assessment years can definitely form tangible material to invoke powers vested with the AO under section 147 of the Act. At the stage of issuance of notice, the AO is only to form a prima facie view. When can the revenue take the benefit of the extended period of limitation of 6 years for initiating proceedings under the first proviso to section 147 of the Act was also decided by the Supreme Court. It is the duty of the assessee to disclose full and truly all material facts which it termed as primary facts. Reopening of assessment cannot go beyond the notice issued under section 148 of the Act and the reasons recorded for reopening. No addition can be made subsequently. Keep watching this space for more interesting videos shortly. Stay safe and healthy. Bye-bye.